to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The Gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
The Word of God says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, rather expose them. Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 11. We welcome you today to our study of Answering Denominational Doctrines. Today we're going to be looking at the Word of God and then looking at a doctrine of men to see if the two match up. There are millions of people who believe that all you've got to do to be saved initially is have faith. And so is the idea of faith alone or faith only taught in the Scripture? We want to encourage you today to have your Bible handy as we're going to look to the Bible and let God's Word determine that answer for us. Friend, we also are so glad that you've joined us in our study of the Word of God today. Our lessons are being brought to you by members and congregations of the Lord's Church. The Lord's Church in your area, the Church of Christ, would love for you to stop by and visit their assembly. Please visit that congregation of the Lord's Church in your area. You'll find people who love God, who love the Bible, and are concerned about lost souls. Here at the Gospel of Christ, we also want to help you in your study of the Word of God. Our motive is to help men and women, to promote men and women to study their Bible and know the Word of God better. And friend, we want to encourage you to visit our website. It's located at thegospelofchrist.com. We've got a wide variety of Bible study materials available. All of our lessons on DVD and CD are available free of charge. You can download those, or you can fill out a media request form, and we'd be happy to mail those to you free of charge as well. Also, don't forget about our app that's for smartphones, both Android and Apple phone, located in both the Android and Apple store, is available. It's free, and it's a great way to study the Word of God as well. Today, we're thinking about one of the more prominent and popular doctrines of men as it relates to salvation. This doctrine is sometimes known as faith alone saves. Friend, is that true? Is it true that all you've got to do to be saved is believe and accept the fact that Jesus is the Christ? Well, let's define faith only first. Martin Luther is one of the major proponents of this idea, and Martin Luther said it this way. Quoting him, he said, "Our salvation is through faith alone. We only," now listen to these words, "it's through faith alone, we only need to believe that our sins are forgiven for Christ's sake, for Christ who died to redeem us." Friend, is that true? That our salvation is through faith alone and the only thing you need to do is believe? Here's another way it's defined. In the Methodist Book of Discipline, they state it this way. We are accounted righteous before God, listen to these words now, only for the merit of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ by faith, and not for our own works or deserving. Wherefore, that we are saved by faith only is a most wholesome doctrine and very full of comfort. A friend, to a lot of folks, it may be full of a lot of comfort, but is it really a wholesome doctrine? Is the idea, this is what we're asking from the Word of God today, is the idea that faith only, that all you've got to do to be saved is believe in Jesus, which both of these statements include, is that really what the Bible says? Friend, please don't misunderstand what we're saying today. We're teaching, and the Bible teaches, that we're not saved by faith only, but please listen very carefully. Is faith essential to be saved and please God? Absolutely. We are absolutely not denying that faith saves, that faith is essential, that it is an integral part in God's plan of salvation, but we are denying that faith alone is all it takes. Hebrews 11:6 teaches us the essentiality of faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. For they that come to Him must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. We want to shout it from the hilltops that you can't be saved without faith. But we also want people to know the Bible never says faith alone saves. Jesus taught us you've got to believe. John 8:24, Jesus said, "Unless you believe that I'm He, you will surely die in your sins." Philip is traveling down the road with the Ethiopian eunuch. He sees water in the distance to be baptized. Here's water. What hinders me? If you believe with all your heart, you may. Acts 8:36-39. And so there's no doubt. It's beyond doubt that faith is essential. But what we're asking is, does the Bible teach faith alone or belief alone is all we have to have? Friend, like the idea, like the false doctrine, which we addressed in our initial lesson in this series, once saved, always saved, the doctrine of faith only is also not true, and God uses, listen now, God uses the exact language of false teachers to prove faith only is not true. Let me put it another way. Did you know that the only time the words faith alone or faith only occur in your English Bible, God says the exact opposite of what millions are teaching? Friend, let me say it so plain that you can't miss that. False teachers are teaching to be saved, all you've got to do is believe. Just have faith only and you'll be saved. And the one time faith only occurs in the Bible, God says that's not true. Now let me show that to you. I want you to look in your Bible. In James 2:24, I want you to see the only occurrence in the English Bible of the idea of faith only or faith alone. Listen to these words. In discussing a true faith versus a faith that won't save, James says, "You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only." This is the only time it occurs. James is writing and he says, I want you to think about the process of a true saving faith. And he says, "You see that a man is justified." Justified means just as if I'd never sinned. "You see that a man is justified by works," listen now, "and not by faith alone or faith only." When God mentions one time in the Bible, in the English Bible, faith only or faith alone, you know what God says? You're not saved by faith alone. Now, friend, does that mean that we are saying you can earn your salvation? Absolutely not. In the Bible, there are two various types of works. There are works of merit, where the Jews said, because we're descendants of Abraham, we have a right to go to heaven. And Jesus said, I can make descendants of Abraham from these stones. Don't say to yourselves, we've got Abraham as our father. There are works of merit where we say, some people say, we've done so many Hail Marys, we've done so many good works, we deserve to go to heaven. And we realize that's not true. Luke 17:10, Jesus said, "And when you've done all those things commanded, you say, I'm an unprofitable servant." But friend, let's not also deny that there are conditional works. There are things we must do to meet God's conditions, which are essential to salvation. Those are the works, the things we need to do that are important, not works by which we've earned our salvation. That's a lot of where the confusion is. Some people will say, well, if you do any works, you're saying you've earned your salvation. Friend, when we do what God says, meet His conditions, conditional works, we don't deserve salvation, but we've got to do that to obey the Lord, right? And so the only time faith alone occurs in the Bible, the Scripture says, you're not saved by faith alone. You're not justified by faith alone. Let that sink in just a moment. Millions of people have been taught, have been told, a host of denominational preachers have gone around the world on campaigns and told people, just believe in Jesus. All you've got to do is believe. And yet the one time God says it in the Bible, we're told we're not justified by faith alone. Friend, that's pretty telling in and of itself. But you know, if we were really going to convince someone, if I were going to convince with great clarity and teach somebody or help someone see that the idea of faith alone is not true, what would I need to do? Well, I would need to show you some examples of people who had faith and were still lost. Now, friend, listen carefully. If we can, if the doctrine of faith alone is true, it simply states to be saved, all you've got to have is faith, and if you've got faith, you will be saved. If we can show examples of people who believed or had faith and were still lost, well, friend, this doctrine's dead in the water. Let me show you five examples of that from the New Testament. I want you to open your Bible to John chapter 12, verse number 42. Turn in your New Testament to the Gospel of John, chapter 12, and I want you to look in verse number 42. I want you to notice what's said about these people here. John 12, verse 42, Jesus said, "Nevertheless, even among the rulers, many believed, many had faith in Him." Believe and faith, pistis, same word there. "Many believed in Him, but because of the Pharisees, they did not confess Him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. For they love the praise of men more than the praise of God." Now, question. Here are people who the Bible says have faith in God, but they won't confess Him. Now, here's the question to consider. If I won't confess Jesus, does the Bible teach I can be saved? Listen to what Jesus said in Matthew 10, verse 32 and 33. Jesus said, "If you won't confess me before men, neither will I confess you before the Father who is in heaven. But if you will confess me before men, I'll also confess you before the Father who is in heaven." And so here are people who believe. They won't confess Jesus. And Jesus clearly said, "I'm not going to confess you before the Father." What's that mean? I'm not going to say to the Father, "This is a child of mine." And so the Bible clearly teaches those ideas are in conflict with the words of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let me give you probably the clearest example, though, and this is so crystal clear. I want you to look in James chapter 2, verse 19. This is the greatest example to see that faith alone is not all you need to save. James chapter 2, I want you to look in verse 19. The second example, clearest of all. James says in James chapter 2, verse 19, as he speaks about the type of faith that will save, here's what James says about the demons. "You believe there is one God, you do well." Listen to this now. "Even the demons believe." That Greek word pistis, have faith. "Even the demons believe and tremble." Friend, I want you to think about the logical conclusion of faith only. Did you know, and it has to be this way if faith only is true, if all you've got to do is believe, did you know a logical conclusion of faith only is that there'll be demons in heaven? Now you think about that for just a moment. If faith is all it requires, the demons believe. What's that mean? The demons have faith. Faith only saves. The demons have faith. Logically, therefore, the demons are going to be saved. Well, friend, is that true? Is James trying to teach that the demons are going to be saved? James says, "You believe in God, good for you." You know what? The demons believe and tremble. What's he saying? It's going to take more than just accepting the mental fact there is God, Jesus is the Christ to be saved. The demons have got that. Jesus at times wouldn't let the demons speak because they knew who He was. "We know who You are. You're the Son of God," they would say, and Jesus wouldn't let them speak a lot of the time. Friend, listen very carefully. Do you know what belief only, you know what faith alone will get a person? Faith only, the only thing it'll get you is a front row seat in the halls of hell right next to all the demons. The demons believe and tremble. Are the demons going to be saved? Absolutely not. They're reserved in chains of darkness for the judgment day, according to Jude and 2 Peter. And so, clearest example is the demons. What type of faith? Listen now, this is so clear. What type of faith is a faith-only, simple mental belief alone type of faith? Demonic. That is not a biblical saving faith. That's a demonic faith. And so there's a stark contrast between what we see here and the false doctrines of men. Third example, John chapter 1, verse 12. Jesus talks to some about faith. And I want you to notice what He says here. Can a person have belief and still need to do other things to be saved? Notice John chapter 1, and I want you to see what the Bible says in verse number 12. Jesus says, "But as many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become children of God." Listen now, to those who believe on His name. To people who believe in Jesus, what did that do? Did that make them children of God? No, listen to John 1:12 again. To those who received Him, Jesus said they had the right to become. Those who believed in Him had the right to become children of God. What does that teach? When you believe, you're still not a child of God. believing alone gives you the right, the privilege to become a child of God. You cannot become something which you already are. And Jesus said, when you believe, when you receive me, that gives you the right to become children of God. And so, again, seeing people here who believe, but we're not yet children of God. Fourth example, John chapter 8, and this is a real clear one as well. I want you to look at John chapter 8. Would you look with me in verse number 30? This whole context of John chapter 8 is talking about the same group of people. And notice what is said in John 8 verse 30. The Bible simply says, as Jesus spoke these words, many believed in Him. Now, in the context, He's talking to that same group of people, to the ones who believed in Him. And notice what He says in John 8, verse 44. Jesus said to this same group of people, "You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it." Now think about this. Here are people in John 8:30 who believe in Jesus, and just a few breaths later, Jesus says, "You are of your father, the devil." Friend, it is possible to believe in Jesus and still be a child of the devil. If all I do, like those in John 12, 42, who believed in Jesus but wouldn't confess Him, if all I do is believe and I've not made any changes, I can still be a child of the devil. And then, of course, we have the example of Saul of Tarsus. Acts chapter 9, our fifth example, is Acts chapter 9, verses 4 through 6. The Lord confronts Saul on the road to Damascus. Saul cries out, "Lord, who are you? I'm Jesus, whom you're persecuting. It's hard for you to kick against the goats." Lord, there's Paul's faith and belief. "Lord, what would you have me to do?" Did Paul at that moment realize he was wrong? Did he realize Jesus is now Lord? Well, sure, he acknowledged that Jesus was the Lord. He believed at that point, couldn't help but believe when he was confronted with that great light. Well, was Paul saved at that exact second of belief on the road to Damascus? No. Jesus says, "Saul, you go in the city. It'll be told what you must do." Ananias comes to Saul, and Acts 22 verse 16 says to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you awaiting? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord." And so these five examples clearly show that a person can believe in Jesus and still not be saved, just like the demons were not saved. Well, friend, what is one of the major problems that makes this a false doctrine that is so easily promoted among people? It's simply this. There are a host of passages in the New Testament that are misused to promote this teaching. And I want to mention three of those specifically today. Oftentimes when we talk to people about the idea of being saved by faith only or belief alone, they'll refer to one of these three passages in dealing with it. They'll say, first of all, well, Acts 2 verse 21 clearly teaches faith only. And in this context, Peter says in Acts 2:21, "Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." And so people say, well, all you got to do is call on the name of the Lord. Someone says, are you denying that? Well, of course not. Are we denying that Peter said in Acts 2:21, "Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved"? Of course not. We absolutely believe that. We teach that. But let's let the Bible explain that, right? Let's let the Bible be its own best commentary. How do you? We don't ask. We're not going to jump to that passage and say, okay, that's it. That's all you got to do. Pack it up and go home. No. We want to ask, what does it mean? What does the Bible mean when it says to call? How do you call on the name of the Lord? Those who would say it means all you got to do is believe, we've already seen that. That can't be true in and of itself. What then does it mean to call on the name of the Lord? Well, we're told exactly what it means, aren't we? The passage we just referred to, Acts 22:16, where Saul is told, "You go into the city, be told you what you must do." Ananias comes to him. Listen now. Ananias comes to Saul, says, "Saul, Saul, why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized." Listen to this now. "And wash away your sins, having called on the name of the Lord." How do you call on the name of the Lord? Friend, you get up and you do what God says to be saved. It's as though a person is drowning or sinking or dying, and they cry out for help, and they believe somebody will help them, and the person throws them the lifeline, and they just sit there and believe. No. You got to reach out. You got to do some things. There's action that's required. That doesn't mean you've earned it. You deserve it. But friend, calling on the name of the Lord, biblically defined, is seen in the example of Saul of Tarsus, who arose and was baptized and had his sins washed away. What about John 3:16? Probably one of the most well-known and misused passages in the New Testament. You know it probably very well. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. People say, well, John 3:16 says to have everlasting life, believe in Jesus. Well, does it say all you've got to do is believe? But more importantly, let's consider the context of John 3. Have you ever thought much about what's going on in context and why Jesus said what He said? Friend, if you'll study John chapter 3, verses 14 through 16, in that context, Jesus is referencing the serpent in the wilderness and how Jesus has been lifted up like the serpent in the wilderness was lifted up, and the examples are parallel. And so take your mind back to the book of Numbers, to that event going on in the camp of Israel. You've got people who begin to complain and murmur. And because of their complaining and murmuring and God being fed up with it, the Bible tells us God sent fiery serpents among them. And the serpents began to bite people. And people are dying. And so they cry out to Moses. Moses cries out to God. And God tells Moses, okay, here's what you do to deal with this problem. I want you to erect a bronze serpent in the middle of the camp. If anybody's bitten by a serpent, they've got to believe that, they got to look on that bronze serpent, they got to go to it, they got to look on that bronze serpent, and then they'll be saved from death. And so, based in that idea, the passage, John 3:16, that's what it comes out of, is the example of the bronze serpent. And so, you take that idea of faith. Friend, in the camp of Israel, when they were being bitten by snakes, was it faith only? You think about this for a minute. You're in the camp with Moses. Maybe somebody, or maybe you've been complaining, and a snake bites you. Are you just going to, at the point of belief, you know there's a bronze, you can't see it, you haven't looked at it, but you know there's a bronze serpent in the camp that'll save. Are you just going to sit right where you are and believe and be saved? Did just accepting the fact that there was a bronze serpent that would save you? Would it have saved people in the Old Testament? No. They had to stop what they were doing. They had to find that bronze serpent, they had to locate it, and they had to look at it. There were actions that were required. Now, in view of that, in John 3:16, God has lifted up His own Son. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. Whoever believes in Him, what do you mean belief? Just accept? No, belief in the Bible requires action. Faith in the Bible is an action word. It's always seen as an action word. Now, what about that third passage? Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. We often hear about the Roman road to salvation. People will say, based on Romans 10, 9 and 10, with the heart one believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And so they think about Romans 10, 9 and 10. Whoever believes with his heart that Jesus is the Christ will be saved. Well, what is all this passage about? Look at Romans 10. I want to show you something from Romans 10, verses 9 and 10, which clearly teaches this doctrine cannot be true. Let me show you from the text. Look at Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. The Bible says this, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now here's a big problem that a lot of people miss. They'll come to this passage and they'll say, you see, the Bible says here, all you've got to do is believe. Wait a minute now. What did verse 9 say? With the mouth. Uh-oh. It's not belief only, you mean? With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. This passage clearly teaches it's not belief alone. You've got to confess and believe, according to this passage. And so we're not saying that these things are not true, but friend, you've got to put the totality of what God says together. Romans 6, 1 through 4, you've got to put the rest of what the book of Romans says. Romans 6, 1 through 4, we are buried with Christ in baptism, in which we contact His death as well. Here's what I want you to see. In the Bible, as saving faith is always active. John 14:15, Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments." Luke 6:46, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say?" Hebrews 5:8-9, Jesus is the author of eternal salvation to all who obey Him. And listen, this passage so clearly refutes faith only. Matthew 7:21, Jesus said, "It's not everybody who looks up in heaven and says, Lord, Lord, that's going there, but he who does the will of my Father." It's not enough to look up in heaven and say, "I believe in God." What have you got to do? You've got to do what Jesus says. Here's the problem with faith only. Faith only leaves out the rest of what God says. Psalm 119:160 says, "The entirety of God's Word is truth." I can't pick bits and pieces here and there. I've got to take the totality of what God says. It's like this. It's like trying to bake a cake without using all the recipe. Let me illustrate it this way. Let's say that this is a recipe book. And on the bottom half of this page, we have part of the recipe. And on the top half of this page, we have part of the recipe. And we don't use this. We're just going to use part of it. So we say, well, this page right here says, take flour, eggs, and salt. We don't look up here and get the rest of it. We're just taking part of it. Flour, eggs, and salt. Okay, so you get your flour, you get your eggs, your salt, you mix it together, and you throw it in the oven. How's that going to taste when it comes out? Well, I'm not eating that, are you? Why? You didn't put all the rest of it in there. You didn't put eggs and butter and sugar and things like that in there as well. Here's what we're trying to say. Friend, does the Bible teach you got to believe? Absolutely. Does the Bible teach you've got to hear the Word of God? Sure. Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. I've got to believe in Jesus, but does the Bible also teach I've got to repent? That's something more than just faith only. Jesus said in Luke 13:3, unless you repent, you'll all likewise perish. We've already seen Romans 10:9-10, if you confess with your mouth. And so I've got to hear the Word of God. I must believe or have faith in Jesus. I've got to repent and confess that He is the Son of God. But friend, listen to what else Jesus said. He that believes and is baptized, not believe alone, he that believes and is baptized will be saved. Mark 16:16. And so friend, we encourage you today, if you have bought into or you have been taught faith only, that's not a wholesome doctrine. That's not found in the Bible. And we encourage you today to obey the true gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wife.
This is the Gospel of Christ.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study material, as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form. Or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905. Or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.
This is the Gospel of Christ.